Alrighty guys, it's Amit here, and welcome back to DevDreamer. So in this lesson then, I want to talk to you about text formatting. Now, so far in these lessons, we've taken a look at the paragraph element, and we've seen that we can use the paragraph element to output basic text to the screen, like so. Now the reason I call this basic text is because HTML actually contains some special elements that are used to format the text and then render them to the screen, and we're going to be taking a look at the vast majority of them in this lesson. So let's begin. The first one we're going to take a look at is the abbreviation tags. Now, as you can probably guess from the name, the abbreviation tags give the browser more information about what things stand for. So for example, HTML stands for Hypertext Markup Language. So let's take a look at an example. First, in our paragraph tags here, let's type in the standard markup language for the web is, and then before we write HTML, let's actually wrap that in our abbreviation tags. And the abbreviation tags are simply open bracket, ABBR, which is short for abbreviation. And then we have our closing abbreviation bracket there. And then inside these, we can type in HTML. Now at the moment, if we take a look at our browser window, this doesn't look any different. And that's because we need to give the abbreviation element an attribute of title. So in here, we just do space, title, equals. And then here, we simply say what this stands for. So this stands for Hypertext Markup Language. So Hypertext Markup Language. And now in our browser window, we can see that the word HTML has this dotted line underneath, which basically denotes that this is an abbreviation. And if you hover over it, it comes up with our tooltip, Hypertext Markup Language. So that's the abbreviation element. The next one we're going to take a look at is the address element. So let's put a break tag in here to go down onto a new line. And the address element is simply the word address. And this usually renders as italicized text in the browser. So let's type in our address here. Let's go for, let's see if you can guess what this is from. 742 Evergreen Terrace. Okay, and then put a break tag in here to go down to a new line. Springfield, you probably got it from that one. It is, of course, The Simpsons. And then finally, down here, we can type in USA. And as you can see in the browser window, this has been rendered as italicized text. Now, you usually find the address tag in the footer section of websites where you have, for example, the company address. So that's the address element. The next one we're going to take a look at is the BDO tag. Let's put a break tag in here. Now, the BDO tag stands for bidirectional override, and this basically reverses the direction of the text. So let's take a look at an example. Let's put our paragraph elements in here, and let's just say the following word is spelt backwards. And before we write our word, let's actually put our BDO tags in here, which is simply BDO, like that. Okay, and in here, let's just say, I don't know, let's just type in coding. Okay, now at the moment then, you can see in our browser that this has not been rendered backwards, it's just still normal. And that's because, just like the abbreviation element, the BDO element requires an attribute. And the attribute it requires is the direction attribute, DIR. Now we've got two options. We've got LTR, which stands for left to right, and then RTL, which stands for right to left. Now naturally, this is being read as LTR, left to right. So let's actually choose right to left, and let's see what happens. And now you can see it says the following word is spelled backwards, NEDOC. I think that's how you'd say that. Okay, so as you can see then, the BDO tag is used to actually reverse text direction. Don't really know why you'd need to use that, but there you go. So let's throw in our break tag here and move on to the next one. So the next one we're going to look at is it's actually a group of elements, and it's basically how to actually render bold and italicized text to the screen. Now there are two ways to do this, and my preference is to do it the second way, but let me show you the first way. So the first way is simply by typing in for bold, you just do opening and closing bold tags, or rather B tags, and then here we can just write this text is bold. Okay, so you can see text is in bold there. Let's throw our break tag in here. And then for italicized text, it's just an I. So I can say this text is italicized. I think that's how you spell it. Okay, so as you can see then in our browser window, we've got bold text and italicized text. Now there is another way to actually output bold and italicized text as well. And it's the way that I actually favor, and it's the way that I actually recommend you to write bold and italicized text, and it's like this. So first, let's just put our break tags in, put two in here, so we can go down to a new section rather than just a new line. And in here, then we can do the following. The first one is strong. So we could say this is a strong. Sorry, not this is a strong. Let's say this text is strong. And as you can see, this text here has actually been rendered as bold. The other one is the em tag. So let's first of all put our break tag in here. And em, which stands for emphasize. And here we can say this text is em, right? So this has actually also rendered as italics. So what's the difference then between writing a bold text using the B tag and the strong tag, and writing an italicized text using the I tag and the EM tag? And the difference is basically the strong and the EM actually give the browser more information. They let the browser know that this text or this phrase or, you know, whatever you use, bold or italicized, it lets the browser know that this is actually important information. Whereas the B and the I tags are simply used just for a visual representation of bold and italics. So I would always favor the strong and EM over using the B and the I. In fact, I haven't actually used B and the I for a very, very long time. Okay, so always go for strong and EM. The next one then we're gonna take a look at is the block quote. So let's just put a break tag in here. And here, let's just say in our paragraph tags, let's just say Buzz Lightyear says, and then down here we can say block quote, and then here we can just do speech marks. And what does Buzz say? Buzz says to infinity and beyond, like so. And as you can see, using the block quote actually indents the text and then it says the actual quote. This is very useful in articles and other text where you have blocks of text and then you actually want to highlight a quotation. So that's the block quote. The other one is the quote tag, and it's quite similar to the block quote, except it actually fills in the quotation marks for us, so we don't have to put them in. So let's take a look at that. So let's just say, let's now say Woody says, and then here we just do Q for quotation. And as you can see, before I've actually typed in the quotation marks here, it's actually done them for us automatically. And here we can just say Woody says, reach for the sky, like that. So the difference between the two then is block quote is actually used to actually indent the text and then show the quote, whereas quote is actually used to keep it on the same line, the same text flow. And also with the quote tags, the quotation marks are put in automatically. So that's the block quote and the normal quote tags. The next one we're going to take a look at is the cite element, and this is basically used to define the title of a work. So it could be a photograph, a song, a film, or a book. So let's take a look at an example. Let's first of all put an image in here. Sticking to our Toy Story theme, we have a Toy Story 3 poster here, and the alt, I'll just say Toy Story. Okay, and we'll take a look at the image tag a bit later on in this series. And then underneath here then we can actually put our paragraph element, and we can say this is a poster for, and then before we write Toy Story 3, let's actually put our cite tags in here. So opening, closing cite tag, and inside here we can say Toy Story 3, and as you can see, Toy Story 3 has actually been italicized. So that's the cite tag. Let's now move on to the next one. The next one we'll take a look at is the code element, and this is actually used to actually define a piece of computer code. So we can just type in opening closing code tags. This is used to define computer code, like so. As you can see, this looks a lot different. It doesn't look like normal text. This is actually the monospace font family. Okay, so that's the code element. Let's take a look at another one. Next one we're going to take a look at is the delete element. Now the delete element actually denotes deleted text. So for example, we can say, let's say roses are, and then let's just do our delete tags, which are just DEL. And here we can say blue, and then outside that we can put red. And we can see here we've got roses are blue and it's crossed out, and then we've got red. Okay, that's the delete tags. Next one we're going to look at is the insert tag. So we can say the word inserted has been inserted into this sentence. And around this word inserted, we can simply do our inserted tags, which are just INS. Like so. And let's just move this into here. And as you can see with this, it's actually underlined our inserted text. So that's the insert elements. Next one we're going to take a look at is the mark element. Now, of all the ones we've looked at so far, this is probably going to be the one that you find the most useful, because the mark element is actually used to define marked or highlighted text. So let's do a paragraph element, and we can say you are watching, and then we can type our mark tags in here, which are simply mark, okay, open and closing mark tags, and here we can write dev dreamer. As you can see now, the words dev dreamer have actually been highlighted here. That's because we wrapped them in our mark tags. And you can actually change the color of this as well by going into the CSS, but we'll look at that a bit later on down the road. Okay, the next one we're going to take a look at, let's put a break tag in here, is the meter tag. Now, the meter tag is basically a HTML5 element, and it defines a scale of measurement within a known range. So for example, your score on a test, or the rating of a product or service, and it's used to actually represent a fixed measurement. So let's take a look at that. So we can just type in meter. Okay, so we've got meter tags here. And as you can see, what we've got here, we've got this this meter bar here. Now, the meter tag actually requires some attributes. So first of all, we need to let the meter element know what the total amount is that this bar represents. So here then, we can just type in max equals, let's just say 10, okay? And we can say the minimum, so what's the minimum amount that this represents? We can just say, let's just say 0. So this then, this bar represents numbers that go from 0, which is here, to 10, which is here. And then we can simply put our value in, and the value is going to be what the actual score is, or the rating. So here then we can just say, I don't know, let's just say 8 out of 10. And as you can see, it's actually filled this up all the way to what would be here, 80%. Now you can change this around, so we can say the max could actually be 100. Now this now represents only 8%, okay? If you make this 50, it would fill it up halfway. Oh, sorry, 950 fills up halfway, 80 fills up a bit more, and so on and so forth, okay? So the meter tag is really useful for actually representing a fixed scalar measurement within a known range. Now the next one we're going to take a look at, put our break tags in here, is the progress element. Now this is kind of similar to the meter tag, except the progress element represents the progress of a task. So this isn't a fixed measurement, it's something that is ongoing. So for example, you can have, in fact let's just put here, let's just write download in progress, and then here, just put a break tag in, and down here we can actually do our progress element. So we can do progress, open and closing progress tags there, and now we've got this here. So within here then, we also need to give it some more information. So again, we give this a maximum, so let's again just go for, let's go for 100, let's give this a minimum, and let's say 0, and let's say this is currently at, I don't know, 74%, so sorry, we've got to do value 74. Okay, so as you can see then, it's actually shown that this progress bar here is filled up all the way to 74%. This would be because out of 100. We could get, again, we can change this to 10 and turn this into 7. And again, it would fill it up according to the value you put in here. So that's the meter and progress elements. Now the next one we're going to take a look at is basically a group of elements called superscript and subscript. So let's put a break tag in here. Now the superscript is actually used on things such as footnotes or dates. So for example, let's just scroll down here. We can say, do some paragraph elements, and let's say my birthday is on February the 7th. Now, before we write th, let's wrap this in our superscript element, which is just sup, okay? And then inside here, let's write th. And as you can see, what we've got here is we've got the text raised up, which is how you'd expect it to look here, Okay. Now the other one is subscript. So we've got superscript, which basically elevates the text slightly, and then subscript does the opposite. It drops the text. So let's put a break tag in here. And now here, let's write, let's say, the chemical symbol. Oh, sorry, let's move this down. The chemical symbol for water is H, and then the 2 on this, on H2O, is actually normally below the line, isn't it? So we can put our sub element in here, and we can say 2, and as you can see now, the number 2 is actually dropped down, and then here we can just say, oh, like that. So it says the chemical symbol for water is H2O. So the superscript tags and the subscript tags are actually useful when actually writing things such as this. So there you have it, guys. Quite a long one, but we have gone through the vast majority of the text formatting elements that you have available to you in HTML. Go through them all, practice them. Please like and subscribe, and I'll see you on the next one.